The title of this is wonderful. It's Make Europe Prime Again. Mm-hmm. Not, of course, that we're not prime. Anyway, it's a play on words, obviously. Amazon Prime, Make Europe Prime. And what we're talking about here is, you know, Netflix and Amazon, we've been talking a lot about today, and how they are global platforms, right? And that gives them a certain kind of clout versus national broadcasters in national countries doing their thing. Obviously, subscription video on demand is a growing, growing thing. So we've heard a lot about that sort of in ancillary sessions, you know, sort of part of the answer in some of the other sessions today. We talked about it a little bit in the nonfiction session, if you were here for that. But this session is basically all about subscription video on demand catch-up, the stuff that Esther was talking about in the last session where she says, oh, on-demand's not so good because they don't want nonfiction, right? So this is about how those platforms are developing, what are they doing, why are they there, are they going to be lucrative for the broadcasters that are backing them, and can anybody really stand up to Amazon and Netflix? So we've got a large panel, but that means we've got a large number of views, which is great. So I'm going to start here and introduce everybody. So first we have, at my far side on the left, we have Robert Amlung. He is head of strategy, digital strategy, sorry, at ZDF. Before joining ZDF in 2001, Robert was a journalist for ARD's news department in Hamburg and as head of news at Arte in Strasbourg. He founded ARD's news website, and I'm going to mispronounce this.
Tagesschau.de.
Thank you very much. In 1996, and ZDF's on... demand video service, ZDF Media Tech, Media Tech, in 2007. So that's Robert. Next, Robert, we have Alexandar Vassilev. Vassilev, I knew I was going to do this.
You did it right.
Did I? Vassilev. He is CEO of 7TV. How many people know what 7TV is? That's interesting. Okay, we have a little bit of an education. So 7TV is a joint venture. It's between ProSieben, Sat.1, and Discovery. Mm. Now, what I like about this is it's kind of an interesting combination, international broadcaster and a local broadcaster. It's not launched yet. It's coming next year, we hear from Alexander. In the interim, Alexander's not just doing nothing. He's actually running three platforms, right? Okay, so you're running Maxdome, if I do something wrong, tell me. Maxdome, Eurosport Germany.
Eurosport Player.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And also ProSieben Sat.1 on-demand service.
No, the 7TV app.
Okay, right, all right. So. Three things, yeah. Right? And we don't really know exactly what's going to happen. You're going to talk more about this. But what's interesting is that probably you're going to kind of merge together, and you're trying to become an aggregator. Mm-hmm. So that's interesting, particularly with our topic. Before he joined 7TV, he spent 10 years at Google, where he built products and developed new businesses across YouTube, DoubleClick, Google Search. So this is a fellow who's has a digital background with one of the big players, which I think is helpful in terms of our conversation. Next to Alexander, we have Annabelle, who's on this page. Annabelle Gawer. Hello, Annabelle. She's director at Code. That's in Surrey. I mean, if I say that you are an award-winning researcher, author, and educator, that's correct, yes?
Yes.
Yes, okay, good. She's an expert on digital platforms, such as Google, Facebook. She was talking about Uber last night, so she does not just media platforms, but just platforms, platform-based innovative business ecosystems. I'm going to say that one more time. Platform-based innovative business ecosystems is what she studies and looks at. She's a leading voice in advancing research as well as advising companies and also policymakers, which I think is important also to the session, including the European Commission, the UK Parliament House of Lords, and the OECD on issues related to the future of ICT and the question of regulation of online platforms, which is obviously a big question right now in the stratosphere that we're dealing with. Next to Annabelle, we have Audrius Perkauskas. Did I say it right?
Yes.
Close enough. He's deputy head of European Commission, DG Connect. I love Brussels titles. I love them. So Audrius, he's deputy head, wait for it, of the audiovisual and media services policy at the European Commission's Directorate General of Communications Networks and Content and Technology, which is called Connect, by the way. Yeah. Okay, that's a good title. It takes up at least two lines. He's been 13 years at the Commission. He's focused on digital economy, society, telecoms, data economy, and media, copyright, audiovisual regulation. Basically, this is the guy you can ask all these kind of hard questions to. Before joining the European Commission, Audrius worked as a lawyer and a lecturer at Vilnius University and advisor to the President of the Republic of Lithuania. And last but not least, who's back on this page, we have Soumya. Soumya Sriraman. Soumya Sriraman is president of BritBox. How many people have heard of BritBox? Okay, good. BritBox, she's based in New York. She used to be in LA? No, you were in Southern California. LA. She's now in New York. BritBox is a joint venture, if you don't know, between the BBC Studios, which is essentially the commercial arm of the BBC, and ITV, which is the UK's biggest commercial broadcaster. Now, it's interesting because, of course, in most cases, you would think these two would be competitors because in their home market, they're obviously fighting for audiences. But abroad, in America and Canada, where this service is up and running, it's been, how long has it been up and running? 18 months? Mm-hmm. About 18 months. So 18 months, not that long. But in this service, they're working together, which I think is very interesting. Before this, before she joined, before she became the head of BritBox, she worked at the BBC. How many years were you at the BBC before? Five or six? Yeah.
Before BritBox, yeah.
Yeah. Right. Five or six.
8 years.
8 years. Okay, right. And then you also worked in distribution, and you were at Vivendi, Universal. So yeah, okay. So let's now that we've got the cast here. It's a big cast, right? Let's start with Soumya. I want to come in with you because you're actually running a subscription video on demand service that is actually up and running, has not been up and running for long. Talk us about the journey of that. In other words, how did that develop? Is it an anti-Netflix? Is this a Netflix killer product? I guess that's the question.
You know, so as I sat through the all the sessions today, I was thinking to myself, this is fascinating. Everyone has this obsession with Netflix, and technically we're all, let's face it, the market's technically grown, right? And I was thinking to myself, really, what we've created is in a growing environment, we've created hyper-fragmentation. There's hyper-fragmentation of content, there's hyper-fragmentation of people's attention, there's hyper-fragmentation of platforms, all of this. Mm-hmm. And I was like, and I'm gonna sadly say I'm part of that devolution. It's not a revolution, it's not a revolution yet, it's not an evolution yet. Today it's a devolution.
Devolution, meaning it's hyper-fragmentation.
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and I think, but proudly, what I will say is that in that environment, what we stand for is we stand for being something for somebody. I do think that Netflix came in wanting to be everything to everybody. And look, their journey happened. Again, I think that in the world of SVOD, SVOD is about audience, it's about discovery. It's about reach, discovery, and community in terms of an audience, mm-hmm. right? And I would say Netflix went for reach. I'm going to be where everyone is. You're in the set-top box, that's where I'm going to be.
Yeah.
I think Amazon used their algorithm. By the way, I'm oversimplifying, but I think you kind of know what I'm trying to say, which is Amazon went for discovery because they could. They have the algorithm, they have the data to be able to say, if you were searching for this product, people like you also happen to do X. And I still believe that Amazon's discovery is actually better than Netflix's, despite Netflix's claims to algorithm. And I would say what we did, we as BritBox came in and decided to be for audience, for a community, to stand for something specific.
Okay. So your USP is not to be another Netflix. It's to be a community based around, I guess, the best of British content?
That's absolutely correct.
Okay. Yeah. So now, 18 months in, what have you got? 500,000 subscribers? How's it going?
Yes, what was announced. We've done quite nicely beyond that, and we're thrilled.
You're thrilled. So
low, low churn. It was one of those things where we were like, we don't know how big the market is. You look at the U.S. and you go, the biggest British shows on PBS, Downton Abbey notwithstanding, get 3 million viewers. Mm. So what does that really mean, right? Like, is that your upper limit of what you can get as an audience, mm-hmm. right? And so you go, so what should a business plan be that plans for those? Mm-hmm. And in all honesty, we've been pleased. We've surpassed all of that. We're well on our path to being a nice self-sustaining business.
Let me ask you a hard question, because I know that some of your subscribers, in fact, I think it's a majority, and you will obviously know this better than I, are coming not direct, but are coming via Amazon channels. Does everyone know what Amazon Channels is? It's an aggregator, right? So you go to Amazon Channels and you can pick channels that you want. And BritBox, I think, is on Amazon
That's
channels.
Correct.
So is, I mean, is that, in other words, you're not going actually direct to consumer for all of your subscribers. You're actually going via one of these big VOD aggregators. Is that a problem?
No, I think that the idea is that you have to be where the consumers are, mm-hmm. right? So if consumers choose that a single bill is their path, and I think Alex will talk about some of this, right? You have to make it easy for them. Now, do I believe that we offer a superior experience? We absolutely do. You come to us, it's more easy to be in a product that's custom made for that person who wants to watch a certain kind of show and follow us on a journey. And Amazon will not be able to provide all of those bells and whistles for that consumer. But if it's easy for that consumer to be part of that aggregated experience, we're happy to support that.
Okay. Do you want to run your clip? Would that be?
Sure.
Okay,
yeah.
so I don't think it's
what BritBox is about.
It's not that long, but this sort of shows the kind of stuff that's in BritBox. Roll the BritBox clip, please.
Happiness hit her like a train on a track.
That'll be all over the internet now.
I'm going to go to Alexandar very quickly, but let me just ask you one question that might transition to what Alexander's going to say. Obviously, you're doing this service outside of the UK. What Alexander's going to talk about is trying to do a service inside of the home country. So your rights issues are quite different than his rights issues. To get your hands on that content in the US, you obviously have to wait for whatever windows have already been sold to broadcasters and things like that. How does that work? And would it mean that you could never bring this into the UK, right? You'd have to redesign it.
That's absolutely correct. Look, it's still an arm's length negotiation. And as you well know, these are very, very complicated rights situations, especially with terms of trade. And I'm sure many of you from the UK read the Enders report from last week, I think it was, about the situation.
PSPs, yeah.
It's a journey we go through, and it's not easy because it's important that we're at the table negotiating for these rights at arm's length.
Mm. Alexandra, let's come to you. In Germany, I'm gonna editorialize here. You correct me. In Germany, there have been several failed efforts to make a joint streaming service work. I think the first one was called Amazonius. I think next was Germany Gold. Help me out here if these are the wrong names. They were all stopped by certain rules that were in place. Take note. Cartel office didn't like them, you know, it was about, you know, anti-competitive behavior, blah, blah, blah. Well, gee, you know, a few years down the line, we've got a situation where Netflix has a pretty big audience in Germany. You've got Amazon with a pretty big audience in Germany. I mean, in the millions, right? You know, 5, 3, whatever it is, million each. So how difficult is it to launch your service now? I mean, you're trying to do something with Discovery to do this now. What do you see as the biggest, you know, difficulties?
First of all, thank you for the invitation to be on the panel. It's great to be here, especially in such an esteemed company. So great to be on this panel.
Yeah.
I think we're in a very exciting moment of video streaming world in Germany. I think Germany is is a really excellent market to try to build the service that we're trying to build. I think if you look today, some of the issues that you described around fragmentation, about a very demanding customer who really, really wants to get quality out of the services they use, and obviously very price-conscious customer that demands a lot of value for each euro they spend. And if you look at the market as it's in its entirety, the video streaming usage has increased tremendously over the last several years. And obviously the entrance of Netflix and Amazon has been quite successful, and those companies have done a great job delivering value for consumers. So I see this as an opportunity for us. So you can say that there's been attempts before to make it happen, but I think we're in the, kind of the golden era of video streaming today. And if we have a chance to build it, I think it's now. And I think we only can achieve the scale and the quality we want to achieve for our audiences through partnerships. And I think that we've taken the first step. Discovery and ProSieben have taken the first step. We've obviously been very public that we are a partnership and want to invite as many people as possible. And I think it's very exciting. So from my perspective, building a kind of a neutral platform that is very open for both content producers, content providers, as well as broadcasters for both content deals and partnerships, but also shareholding, I think gives us a great opportunity to build kind of the single entertainment hub in Germany and the local champion of choice for the German consumer that delivers the content that they can really connect with.
Okay. So what I'm hearing is that your USP, your unique selling point, is this, you know, local champion of choice. I like that. That's a good phrase. You know, Soumya was saying a community, creating a community, best of British content. What are the, it seems to me one of the things you're going to have to figure out pretty well is the user interface, because that's what Netflix has down really well, and as Soumya said, Amazon's is in some cases even better. So is the, what are your key things that you're working on? Is it user interface? Is it price point? Is it what content you have? I mean, what are the, where, you know, what's the top of the pile in terms of what you think is most important?
It really is the whole package. So, you know, if I can take you through our thinking is that obviously content is still king. So to achieve the scale we want to achieve and our ambition and to deliver really the value we want to deliver, first of all, we have to focus on the content. And when we think about content, we think in a very specific way. We think about global stories, which is, you know, where people go to explore. I want to be the next Wonder Woman, the next Superman, etc. And they will go also to this content. And also what, on the other side, local narratives, as we call them. And when I use local, I don't use it as a proximity metric. For example, we keep in with our team discussing that, for example, in India, the majority of the local football club is Manchester United. So you see people with shirts and they feel good passion. So we think about local narratives, narratives as narratives that people can feel belonging to. Right? When you see, you know, Voice of Germany, when you see the person speak, singing with the same accent that you have, obviously you can feel much more belonging. So we see this kind of duality of content, and I think we will serve both. We have the ambitions to serve both, but where we really want to focus is on that locality. And our mission, obviously, is to connect the audience locally to that content. So that's the one part that we're working very hard to build, and you build that through partnerships, through productions, etc., trying to aggregate that content.
So content's king.
Content
How
is
about
king.
User interface and price?
And I was just getting to that. I think one thing that stems from the variety we have in the market today and the demand, demanding nature of our customers and users is the fact that they want a new experience. They want a simple experience. They want, in a world where there's 20 apps, you have to differentiate through the experience. And I think it's extremely important for us. And the way we think about it is that it's not about just, you know, throwing the content in your face, but how do that content is curated? Is it intuitive? Is it easy to use? Is it focused on you rather than anybody else, right? The call curation for the audience, for the masses versus curation for the individual. So keeping it short, it's extremely important. We focus quite significantly on it, and we're spending a lot of time and resources thinking about how to deliver a great experience.
How about price?
Price, yeah, the German consumer, again, it's very...
Because you're going to have to price against Netflix and Amazon, right? Or not?
But see, this is, I go back to what Sonia said in general is, you know, people tend to make it a kind of a zero-sum game. You have to compete to Netflix to be successful. You have to compete to Amazon to be successful. They have to not be successful in order for you to grow. But as she said, the pie is growing. I think there's quite a bit of opportunity to establish yourself as the local champion of choice. In Germany alone, people have 2.5 subscription on average.
Really?
This is 2.5. A very, very interesting market. I don't think it's a zero-sum game. Okay. So pricing is important because you have to give the most value for you, for the consumers, for the every euro they spend. But I don't see it as a competition of how much is Netflix priced or Amazon Prime is priced for me to make a price point that's attractive.
Okay. So you said you want to let everyone into the tent. You're inviting other people in, including even maybe your biggest competitor, RTL, including perhaps ZDF. Now, I think there's actually some news about ZDF today. Yes. Robert?
Yeah, it was announced that for our live signal, the live TV programs, that they will be available through your platform as an OTT streaming. So something that we offer for everyone in the market. This is not a particular deal for ProSiebenSat.1. We have it with Zattoo, we have it with Magine, we even offered it to also our colleagues from RTL for TV. Now it's freely available. And it's part of our philosophy that we say the distribution has to be as broad as possible. So if there are relevant players in the market that can distribute our content, well, they can do it if the well, if the rights are clear, then that all.
Yeah, yeah, and you can do a commercial deal. Yeah. Do you, for instance, are you on Amazon channels? Are you on that aggregation platform?
We have some channels on Amazon through our commercial distribution daughter. Yes.
Right, right. So how do you? I mean, I was thinking about we had an interesting conversation about bad banks. Right, remember that was that six-part thriller series, and you talked to me about that when we were talking. You said it was produced by Germany's Letterbox Film Production and Luxembourg's Irish Production, with participation by ZDF and also Arte. But you produced it with the new distribution models in mind, you said. Can you explain that? How does that work? Because we're hearing about storytelling and how important the content is.
Yeah, yeah.
So how are you thinking about distribution, even when you were thinking about that program?
Well, we thought about how to make that transition from linear only into a world where linear is still strong, but where non-linear distribution is growing rapidly. So we thought about, well, doing something for linear only and for online only, and we got away from that because we think content-wise there's much overlap. And from the business point of view, financing online only is still very hard. So what we are doing now is what we call online first. And so many of the productions that we do, the original commissioning in fiction and documentary, is done online first. That means that, of course, there will be a linear version that will be broadcast eventually. And this will, for some time, being still have the largest audience. But we try to use all these new windows of opportunity of distribution in the nonlinear world according to their rules. And this means that we... for instance, for Bad Banks, we put that online first, before the linear distribution. And we offered it on binge, so all the six episodes were available at the same time. And they are available. They were available for more than half a year in the Mediathek. So we are extending also the windows from the mere catch-up of 7 or 30 days to something that is a couple of months, because we think for the Mediathek to be a potentially successful platform, it needs to move beyond just being a catch-up platform.
When you, and this may be a hard question, but when you look at, for instance, what 7TV is doing, because as you said, you're putting your linear, live linear on there, and as you said, you want to be on as many platforms as you can be on that makes sense, because obviously you're trying to reach your audience. Would you get involved in an SVOD platform, a subscription video on demand platform, as a PSB, as a public service broadcaster, does that make sense for you? Is that something that you have to pass by the policymakers, or is that something you think makes sense? Or?
Well, we've been involved in both the Amazonas project and Germany's Guild. From the very beginning, we've decided that for the commercial platforms, this is something interesting for ZDF as not just the public service broadcaster, but we have this commercial distribution arm.
Yes.
Which is just a commercial company. So whenever a commercial platform is involved, this is not the public service broadcaster who's acting. And ZDF Enterprises, as the distribution company, has always been very interested in the SVOD world from the beginning, as there are commercial opportunities that ZDF itself cannot use, because there is media legislation in place that limits the amount of time that we can offer our content online. Mm-hmm. Ah. And so there has to be some sort of windowing policy for that we defined as being, well, all the new things are on our own platforms as ZDF public service broadcaster, free of charge, free of advertising. Mm-hmm. But after some time, there are commercial windows kicking in. Uh-huh. And this is where the license deal and the cooperation deals with these platforms start.
So it sounds complicated, Alexandar, but it sounds like you could do a deal. Why don't we do a deal right now, and then we could actually say we did a deal at...
I didn't bring my pen, so...
You didn't bring your pen? Yes. Oh, damn. Okay, but it sounds like you're talking, and not absolutely. Just you two, but in other words, the organizations are talking about getting involved. So, Annabelle, I want to come to you. You know, as a researcher and academic, you look at competitive advantage. We were talking about that a lot the other night. You know, how can platforms not only survive but succeed in this world? So you've just heard, you know, kind of what's going on in Germany, what Soumya is doing with BritBox. What's your view on this? What's going on with platforms, particularly in the media world?
Right. So it's a fascinating learning experience for me to be at this conference. I know a little bit about the media market, but I know a lot about how in other industries tech companies have entered other markets and have radically disrupted the whole market dynamics. So perhaps where I can be shedding some light is not so much into the what you guys know a lot more than I do about the very details of what's happening in your market and then the newest product and the newest alliance, but perhaps attempt to give a bit of a broader view. So you know, tech companies have entered the media market, right? Netflix and Amazon, Google with YouTube. Some people think Facebook is the biggest media company in the world because of the way it aggregates and shares news. And they don't own any content, by the way. So just like with every big revolution, a technological revolution, there is a real profound reshaking of the industry and the structure of the industry, who's on top, who's below. It's a new deal. And just like with the previous big revolutions, you know, like 100 years ago, Industrial Revolution, I think now we are really at an inflection point where the big actors of yesterday are still there. Many of them were, if we look at their financing model, like the BBC and others, there was a state, a deep connection to ways of finance that kind of generation of content and diffusion of content and a mission, which was to educate and entertain basically the British citizens in the UK, right? And there was a particular way to organize work within these media companies. Again, with the BBC, you had news, you had, you know this better than I do, you know, sports, you know, fiction, you know. And these were really companies where, and I keep hearing this since this morning, content is king. I keep hearing that as a mantra. Is it something you try to reassure yourself about?
Yeah.
I just love it. Just like whenever I hear something like that, which is repeated over and over again, I'm like, why do they keep saying that? And the reason I'm asking this as an external person to media industry is, first of all, this word content is a little bit strange. Because the reason I watch anything is not because it's called content. It's a bit more like what you said. What you said, there's meaning in it, there's something I learn from it, something I get entertained by. So calling it content is a sort of supply-side view of people who put a content in a box. And that's the box of yesterday, and there's content, and now we're working about the streaming, and we get a little bit lost here, I think, about what are the new ways to create value for people who watch, who read, who listen. And I would like to use these very simple words as opposed to consume content, not just because we don't just consume knowledge or imagery or fiction, it's because we learn by it, we get inspired by it, and also because even if I put my economist hat, the word consumption means something very specific. And when we used to teach business and economics to students, we said the very elemental building block that everybody needs to understand when you want to understand how markets operate is a transaction. And a transaction happens between two types of roles, a buyer and a seller. And the buyer consumes and the seller sells. And there is money going this way and consumption of something going that way. However, in the world of platforms, this isn't like that anymore. You don't have two players. You have three players. You have a platform, for example, think about Google. You have what economists call the sides of the platform. So if you think about Google search, you're going to have people like you and me who engage with the platform. By the way, we're not exactly consumers in the old sense because we don't pay Google per search. But we engage with Google to get to get some content.
To get content or maps or whatever it is.
Whatever it is that we want at that time. So, for example, an answer to a search query and the business models. Because I think what we haven't spoken about explicitly, and I think everyone should speak a bit more explicitly about the business model, are in this particular case the advertisers who pay Google. Now, what I, as a search user, engage with Google for, the value that I get from Google is fundamentally different from the value that the advertisers get from Google. So to think more in a little bit more sophisticated way about the business of platforms, and that's the it's a bit of a plug for my next book, which is called The Business of Platforms.
I love it. Which you can probably get on Amazon very soon, right?
Pre-order it.
So I have a question for you.
No, just a minute. So the structure
I'm just trying
of
to bring you.
The structure of those business models is where you have different sides that connect to each other, and they have these so-called network effects, so you have these viral growth.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So just to summarize what you said, what do I think about this is I'm sure there is a huge amount of demand for local content. And I'm sure people, even in the post-Brexit world, love Brit content. I fell in love with Britain again just watching that wonderful video. However, the question I think that everybody has to think about is sustainable business models when media companies are competing. And I agree with the pie is growing, but there's still competition. With companies who subsidize some activities with other activities, right? So the way Amazon makes money is not because of Prime Video. They make money because of AWS, mm-hmm. all right? So what we need to figure out is what is the survival unit, the minimum unit of survival, if you want to be a media company, when you compete with companies for which media is just one of the things that they do.
That's a really good point.
Isn't it?
That's a really good point. Now, do you have something to say about that? Because that's a really, I mean, the business model, what she said here about when you think about what the business model is, because we all need to get into this, right? We need to get into if it's catch up, if it's advertising VOD, if it's SVOD, whatever it is, because that's where the audience is. They want it, yeah? But what is the business model? This is a tough one, Alexandar, right?
Yes, it is, and interesting take on content. I think of content as the thing that people come to a platform for. I mean, again, that's what we mean by content is king. A platform
without
content.
What is the business model behind that? Because as you say, you know, Netflix is subsidizing their growth with debt, right?
That's absolutely.
Amazon is subsidizing their growth by selling, I don't know, more groceries and
Whole Foods.
Roll and Whole
that
Foods.
That I'm now addicted to. Oh, I'm a Prime member. Yes, please tell me more.
Yeah.
What is the business model? I mean, again, we can go back to discussing, you know, the freemium model versus, you know, a pure pay for consumption, ad supported, et cetera, et cetera. But again, in the end of the day, it's about creating value, right? It's about figuring out how does your platform delivers the maximum amount of value for the end consumer. This is it's simple as that, right?
No, it's not actually. That's just one part of it, right? Because that does. How do you deliver not just the maximum amount of value? That's not the right way. If you were to deliver the maximum amount of value, you'd give it all for free. That would be the way you'd give the maximum amount. So you obviously know nobody can do that.
No,
it's how do you give more value than the competitors?
Yeah, no, look, at the end of the day, it's all about, it's what you said to me. We make people believe in Britain again that I'm willing to open up my pocketbook and keep it with you.
Exactly.
It's that emotional connection.
Exactly.
And what are they willing to pay for that emotional connection? By the way, sometimes it's convenience, sometimes it's connection.
Exactly.
I'm a big believer that the reason I still think content is king and the consumer, and you made a point, which is to me, platform has to be the means through which content gets to the consumer.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it is. And the platform has to be kind of oblivious, right? It can't be the solution. We are using a platform to deliver the right content to the right person.
I think you're absolutely right. And I think the reason why your value here is so valuable is because it's unique. And that's because right. nobody can compete with that's British right. content if they're not British content.
And,
right?
Yeah, and that's so there exactly is the what you're trying to do, too. Exactly. Alexander's got the same proposition. No, it's create same, community, I mean, create, you know, some local content, or as you said, content appeals to those whatever those local audiences
listen, at the end
are.
Of the day, what you guys said is actually true. It's about listening to the consumer as a right. platform. Yeah. Reflecting on what that consumer tells you, and then connecting them with the right content or videos or whatever right. news it is it's right. your platform does, that they feel belonging to. That's as simple as that. And again, whether you think that that's can be you know to achieve a growth, you have to borrow or you have to be subsidizing right. in somehow way. I think this is just a means to an end, right? How fast you're growing and how competitive your market space is.
Yeah,
but
in
the end of the
Netflix
day, it's about yeah. It's not about, for example, for a platform like ours, we are not in the business of broadcasting. We are not broadcasting ourselves. The platform itself is a facilitator to connect people yeah. with content.
Okay, Audrius, I want to bring you in now. Okay,
with pleasure.
You've listened to this, yes. You're from the commission. What do you think? do you think that these guys can make it all work? Is the commission going to back this horse? And the next thing we're going to get into is sort of is there a potential for an EU-wide, and I'm afraid Britain won't be in it, but anyway, an EU-wide SVOD platform. I mean, is that something that the commission would get behind? Do you think that's a good idea? Do you think that's a way to preserve, I don't know, culture, values, consumer good.
Yeah. By the way, Robert just said he can't be part of that. His remit doesn't allow him to have a...
Interesting.
Yeah.
Oh,
sorry.
But on those questions, indeed, first of all, let me say I'm extremely happy what people around me are doing because they are launching all these new projects, typically in partnerships. And it's not obvious at all, I think. Here in Germany, Netflix and Amazon are expanding. And it will get only scarier because Disney strengthened with Fox and Comcast. And so there will
Disney
be,
Life is going to launch. You've already got some kind of
much
Sky
more,
thing here, I think. Yeah.
Much more things coming from us, potentially with lower price tags and so on. So I'm very happy that you guys are not intimidated by this. You don't see those famous dead zones around Netflix or Amazon. So that's the first great news. Now, if we want to see a European platform as a global champion, let's say, of course we do. Let's say we don't have a lot of successes recently in the tech scene. One exception, perhaps, is Spotify in this broad field of creative content. Spotify started when iTunes, rich iTunes library was around and managed to make it. It was, I don't think it was easy. They started in Europe, they went through the US to scale and then back to Europe. And with loss-making for many years, ultimately it worked. So in that sense, it feels good to have these type of companies, that's for sure. Now, having said that, I don't think our objective as such would be any type of pan-European film or video platform just to add to all what is happening already on the market. So probably intuitively, from the European Commission point of view, we would encourage to search for new ways to bring Europe's rich cultural diversity to the fore and to the attention of US. So this is one thing. And to continue innovating from a technological point of view, because this conference is excellent. It brings not only content, it highlights not only content as a king, but also some technologies as future drivers. So we heard about artificial intelligence, voice assistants, blockchain, I believe, was mentioned as well.
We can hear more of that later. Yeah.
So you know, probably there is a potential to exploit these things. And I have met one startup during the lunch break who said, "Look, we want to do blockchain to connect."
Ooh, is that me? No. That's you. There's another mic. Is there a mic on a table? Does somebody see it? Oh yes. Well. Hold on. Is there another mic down here?
I don't.
Yes.
No.
I don't see one.
Is there one now? Oh,
nope.
There isn't one there.
It's okay.
Hand
him
your
you
mic. Yeah. Hand him your mic.
I will share.
Share a mic. Yeah. Go ahead.
So perhaps there is a potential to use this decentralized blockchain technology to connect our fragmented creative scene with US and ensure that all that works in a transparent way. and that creators have control over when they want to put the content into the platform, and importantly, they have a good visibility of what happens with the content on the platform with data analytics and everything. So
okay, so let me ask you a question. I get your point. Is the EU or the Commission willing to help make this happen? Because certainly in the past, you've been helping not make this happen, would be my humble estimation. I mean, is there something that, and you guys can barrel in on this, is there something that needs to happen? Do you think it's a good idea to have an EU-wide SVOD service? Does that make sense, Robert? Do you think it makes sense?
Well, it's a debate that we have intensely in Germany at the moment, because many politicians feel it should happen, that
there should
be a European champion in place.
Right.
And I think as Europeans, we all feel that nagging feeling of uncertainty as big American companies come in.
Huh? Yeah.
Because they're culturally different, they're legally different, and it's much easier, and I can say that from experience, to deal with European companies than dealing with big American ones.
Mm-hmm.
And this being said, we have to acknowledge that for a European-wide problem, that there is a cultural and language barrier.
Mm-hmm.
And that all those that are doing something on a European basis are paying heavily on learning this lesson on how to localize their offering.
Yeah, because it may be pan-European, but you also need to make it local.
Absolutely have to, and you have to translate.
Mm-hmm. You have to translate.
Have to translate.
But we've got all this technology now. You can almost do immediate.
Right. Yeah, but
blah blah.
Not really in the quality that you'd need for really a B2C business. Most of this is still a KI that can do something that helps automate it for.
Okay, so the politicians like it. You say, do you want to do something like this, Alexandar? Do the commercial entities want a pan-European wide SVOD service, or does that just not make any sense?
It goes back to, are we thinking big? Or are we not, really? It seems to me. I think from our perspective of 7TV, obviously we consider Germany our core market. We want to succeed, and we have a proposition. I think it's slightly different what the market is moving today. Obviously, if that turns successful, then we can think about synergies of going pan-European.
Mm-hmm.
But if we're honest among ourselves, there are pan-European products.
Yes.
Amazon, Netflix, those are pan-European products who've solved the issue of localization to a certain extent to give growth. Can we do it better? I think from Europe we can do it better because we understand the local consumer better. So that's my take on this thing. So I think it's possible.
Mm.
I think it will be great to have. I think is a service that again goes from a different directions of understanding this continent and building.
And does Annabelle and Audrius need to talk to the Commission? Because Annabelle talks to the Commission, Audrius is at the Commission. Do they need to be thinking in different ways? What message do we need to be sending to the Commission? I don't know, for regulation, or is it just going to work? Is it going to just work now? I don't know. What do you think? Or Audrius?
I would like to step in there, because
yes,
I think one thing where the Commission could be helpful, it's about making all the rights issues easier.
Mm-hmm.
And helping us to set up an environment regulatory-wise, as you're doing with the Audiovisual Media Directive and the Copyright Directive and all the things that you're actually doing, and to help making it in a way that from a practical standpoint of just setting up business and setting up services, it's getting easier to do that for the whole European market. And I think there is still room for ample improvement, because in recent years, you know that better than I do, that, of course, there's extensive lobbying pressure in Brussels.
Right.
And this lobbying pressure, in many cases, in my experience, has led to something that would, from a legal point of view, be very precise and very pristine, but from a practical point of view, almost unworkable.
Yeah.
And helping us find solutions that are both okay from a legal point of view, but workable. I think this is something where the Commission could really help us.
Good point.
This is a fair criticism. Brussels is known for its famous compromises, which precisely become a bit difficult to find in practice.
Yeah.
But you're right. I mean, what we were doing recently is precisely to try to set the rules which treat everyone equally who is on the market. So in particular, with recent reforms of copyright and audiovisual regulation, we went in the direction of saying, look, new players like platforms are also kind of content providers, so we should see what rules from content regulation should apply to them as well. We are less good, I must say, at fostering European champions, so inevitably we will depend on markets. We could help if research funding. We could have help with some, hopefully some deployment funding in the future, because now Europe is considering its next multi-annual budget, and part of it is so-called Digital Europe program, which will go in the direction of helping with the deployment of blockchain, artificial intelligence, and so on. Mm-hmm. So we can do those things, but we will not really put in place a new SVOD as such. We could have ideas, and from this conference, for example, there could be ideas, since subtitling is becoming easier, and for example, since those players like Netflix and Amazon were a bit less, let's say, interested in what we call documentaries. Why not a platform combining news content, documentaries, and the documentaries coming from different countries?
Kind of an Arte, pan-European Arte with news and current affairs focus. I mean, in broad
never
strokes.
Never make it work without fiction.
Yeah, I think you need fiction, yeah. So Soumya, how about if we scale back our ambition and we just have BritBox in across Europe?
Woo-hoo.
Is that something that you're thinking about? I mean, are you expanding? You know, I mean,
I'm a cheerleader.
Yeah. Well, I mean, is that your next move to sort of bring BritBox to Europe?
In the post-Brexit world.
You started the conversation with rights.
Yeah, we may be leaving the damn union, but you still sell programming. Yeah. Go ahead.
Like these are things that our parents and the businesses that they do here we're looking at constantly, right? There's meetings that I'm in. I like telling the story of the fact that in the U.S., my business plan got approved in 2013.
Really?
And
but you didn't launch till 2017.
Exactly.
Wow, that's really quick, agile, flexible, iterative. Yeah, not.
No, but circumstances are complex. You know, Annabelle talked about having a sustainable business, and that was very, very important. And yeah, I think that in order to have a sustainable business, you put together a plan that you think is going to have long-term, right? And you still go into it trepidatiously going, I don't know if we're going to make it.
Exactly.
And I'm proud to say we have, and seems like we will continue to. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we want to do the same in the other markets, right? So you don't get into it without understanding what the right things to do are.
Right.
Mm-hmm. One thing I want to ask before we go to the audience questions is about original content, because we all remember the journey of Netflix. It started versus DVDs, but then it started, it was just acquiring content, right? Mm-hmm. Then they got into commissioning original programming. Now, of course, they want to label everything their original program. We heard earlier about some of the fights that go on about that. Mm-hmm. You are basically archive and current programming, but you're now getting into commissioning, and when did you make that decision to do it, and how much original do you need to make it work? And then I'm going to ask you this as well.
Yeah. It's fascinating. Look, I went into it with the belief that you can just offer a destination that feels right, and people will come to it. If you build it, they will come. Mm-hmm. Kevin Costner said so it must be right. So, and kind of very soon what you learn is, unfortunately, Netflix didn't say so it might not have been right for you. Mm-hmm. And Netflix decided that consumers wanted originals.
Mm-hmm.
And
or at least they think they're originals.
Yeah, that's what they think they are, right? Yeah. It's not like we didn't have new shows. We had new shows that were day and date with BBC and ITV. But you suddenly realize it's the labeling of the content. Mm. Because Netflix had brainwashed people into believing that if you didn't have originals, you were not a legit platform or service. Mm-hmm. And we've been traversing that journey. Do I know how many originals we need in any given year? I don't. Right? We're gonna do this a little bit.
You've done a couple. I mean,
trial and error, right?
Yeah.
We've done a couple. We launched our second one actually just last week, and it's done incredibly well.
Has it?
Right. Yeah. So
is it because it's localized for the U.S. market, or because it's just original, or what do you think was the thing?
Fascinating. The first one was absolutely customized. It was we brought back Bletchley Circle, but we brought it back as Bletchley Circle, San Francisco. Mm-hmm. Right. So that was absolutely customized.
So it was kind of a format, but put in a different location.
Exactly.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And this one was
Dark Heart, which
Dark
was a co-commission with ITV.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So it's very much a British story with Chris Lang. And I mean, again, amazing story and a good journey. But when you think about the journey that those of you who are familiar with the show know, it went from ITV Encore to then making its way onto the main channel. So look, we're going to learn this by rote. Right, and we're gonna see how things go.
What do you think about original?
I take a slightly different approach, and I may sound like a broken record right now, but for me, it's when a user or consumer or whatever you want to call it, our audience comes to our platform. Is there something interesting for them to watch? Simple as that. Now, how do you make that happen is, one, through partnership, because we have partners who produce extremely good content that engages our audience, A. B, through other partners that you try to bring in as an aggregator. And of course, we think of original content as the thing you need to have to kind of fill those gaps if that's not enough. We already have original content when it comes to jerks in the market. Mm. We obviously working on.
You commissioned that, didn't you? Or you
it's a Max Dom original.
It's a Max Dom original. Okay.
So would that come from something that we produce, or something we buy exclusively, or something we co-produce with partners? Mm-hmm. It's less about that. It's more about having it on your platform where people can engage with interesting content.
No. But you don't want to do too much, because then of course that throws the monkey wrench into Annabelle's business model again, and you know you're then putting too much money out, and you're not recouping it, and if you're in the business of not doing what Netflix is doing, is just borrowing billions and billions and billions to fund the machine that keeps going, or if you're not in the business of Amazon that's in, is selling other stuff so you can just fund the machine that keeps things going, you're actually trying to make a profitable business, correct?
Sure, sure, but again, that's why I would join you in the assessment that there's not a magic number. You know, right now, you see a lot of discussions and companies try to benchmark Netflix is spending $13.5 billion, how much are you spending? Mm-hmm. And I think that that's a slightly irrelevant question. I think, again, when the people come to Netflix, do they have something to watch to interest them? Yes or no? Check. Mm-hmm. Do they come to your platform? Do they have something interesting to watch? Check. And I think, for example, I will produce originals, we'll produce exclusives, we'll produce co-productions, etc. That's an important factor of making the content available to people. Mm-hmm. But again, our partners produce already fantastic content. So we need to take a look at kind of, as a platform, what do we have on?
Yeah, how you package it.
Yeah, how do I package it?
And how you curate it.
Yeah, how do we curate that content and do people have something to watch? Yeah. If the platform feels fresh, if it feels like it's dynamic, if new things are coming up that engages the audience, great.
By the way, if the numbers that Mark put up earlier today are any evidence, if those of you remember the market cap chart, you go, Netflix is whatever, $12, $14 billion annual revenue, market cap of $150 billion. Walmart, annual revenue of $500 billion, market cap of $270.
Right.
Yeah, craziness.
Right. So I mean, it basically tells you that the market and people are willing to pay a premium on this kind of business, this kind of content.
Yeah.
I just want to comment on that because I did a report looking at market capitalization of platform firms or firms who describe their business model as platforms, and it's very clear that investors love the platform business model, and in particular the platform business model that doesn't have a lot of asset, like an Uber or an Airbnb or a Facebook, where what you do is being a channel of communication across people who generate their own content or drive their own car. And by the way, they're not on your payroll. And by the way, they're just contractors. And people who are not really your customers, so you don't really have any responsibility vis-a-vis them either, but they just connect through you. And 70 plus, almost 80% of all unicorns, so unicorns are firms whose private valuation exceeds $1 billion, more than 70% of them describe their business as a platform business model, okay?
Uh-huh. Very so, smart, huh?
Well, yeah, not all of them obviously are going to succeed, but there's something there about, again, the difficulty to play a race when you have an arm tied behind your back. And so I completely agree with what you say about the interest for unique content and that people, you know, the demand side, right, demand and supply, the demand side will value original content, and that's all true. But again, as an economist and professor of business strategy, there is a very important question about what we call the scope of the firm, right? What is the optimal way to deliver all these goods? And all these goods are now connected with each other in a digital way. So there is a concept of industry structure or even industry architecture. And the question will be, yes, 100 years ago or 50 years ago, a firm like the BBC both did the content and the delivery. Netflix and Amazon started with the delivery, then they moved into content. We understand that the way they subsidize these businesses, they are not self-standing businesses. Mm-hmm. So we need to think creatively around how do you sustain businesses that maybe some of them provide content, some of them provide distribution, some of them may ally themselves as a coalition to be almost like a buyer's group against Netflix and Amazon, perhaps at the European level. There are many different ways that this pie has to be cut. And we cannot just reuse the old same bottles. It's not just producing new content. It's producing new content, new business arrangements, new business models, new business ecosystems, new ways of transacting and protecting intellectual property that are sustainable in a systemic industry levels. And what I'm a little bit worried about is I hear companies focusing on their own business model at the firm level, but they are competing with these huge conglomerates such as Amazon that have systemic synergies across businesses. And also, let's remember that both in France, in England, and other countries, the way original content was usually financed was basically by the state. Is it possible to make money out of content alone? You know, advertising's played a big part of it, but today the giants in advertising happen to be Google and Facebook. So rethinking business models, not just at the firm level, but at the level of the industry, is something that requires people going around a table and putting their heads together to think about that as a systemic problem.
And let me just add one important thing. This is not all new. Of course, there are new elements in it, but we're doing originals for 55 years for a reason. And I think that Netflix has discovered that reason when they started going into originals.
Yes, they did.
And others in this new business as well are discovering lots of things, of course, that we knew as a traditional broadcaster. And we are definitely having the strategy to capitalize on this experience that we do have and on the things that we do know and not just try to rethink everything. Of course, we have to learn some new elements.
Exactly.
Some new scale as well.
Exactly.
This is very important.
And also maybe use the fact that some of these companies offer as a service all sorts of technologies as well.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, exactly. Audience, would like somebody have a question? There's one way back there, if there's a mic back there, or just get up and talk and I'll, or come down to the sound desk, he can give you a mic. Talking to the microphone, there you go. Is there another one somewhere as well?
She's ready.
No? Go ahead, yep.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yep.
Hello. So, Catherine Brunner, my name. I've worked in the German video on demand industry since 1999, so not quite 20 years, but quite a lot. Worked with a lot of platforms. Thank you, Ms. Gawer, for your words. I think they're very, very true if you look at the German market. I think what I have the feeling, and you're mentioning is already, is in Germany, we've had many platforms, 40, 50 platforms. I don't know how many platforms I personally developed among that. Mr. Amlung knows it, the Germany's Gold platform. There were very many good attempts that were basically stopped too early. I heard a lot of, this is not working, and we're not throwing good money after bad money. And my feeling at the moment in the German market is, we've passed the point where we have Netflix and Amazon that have 50% market share. Netflix has not even maybe one or two, but they don't even have any employees in Germany anymore. Mm-hmm. The people that worked in German video on demand companies all moved to Amsterdam, working for them. And
That's a way to avoid tax, I think. But yes go ahead. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but even so even the workplaces away. So I think it has to be a phase where we have to be brutally honest that we just missed this market. And basically, probably we missed it European-wide. There's been some good platforms in Europe, like whatever. But we just didn't have the guts to go through. And I think this is what Ms. Gawer also said, we have to come to terms that we have people out there, and I would not really like to talk to them as consumers. We have people that like to watch films and series and television, and we have a young generation. I have a 15-year-old at home that grew up with Instagram. They grew up with Facebook.
Right.
My 15-year-old at home, she turned on the television once this year, which was Germany's Next Top Model.
So what do you think? So you're basically saying throw in the towel. In other words, don't even try to do video on demand.
To throw away words like this is content, because the content that we have was produced for TV.
Okay, so re-envision.
TV is a different consumption model. It's something where I sit, where something is presented to me.
Right.
And now we have other platforms that have been developed, like Netflix, for 20 years.
Yep, okay.
where basically what I watch there has to work in a different way. And okay. This is also why they make originals. It's not because they want that as a marketing proposition. It's because what works on an interactive platform is needs to be different.
Okay, I think that's a really good point. I'm gonna stop you there because I think we got your point. Does anyone want to react to that? You know, this idea that really in some ways, we've sort of talking about this, but you have to think about it in a different way. It's a different kind of platform. It's a different kind of product. Maybe it's a different kind of service. Yeah. Maybe it's, I don't know, maybe it's different kind. Maybe you need to have interactivity. I don't know. It was funny on the nonfiction panel. Christian, I think we're talking about doing something with WhatsApp, right, wasn't it? So WhatsApp and doing this very cool thing where people got involved and they actually found the two pictures that were in the documentary that they hadn't lost during the blah, blah. And this is a different kind of content. Maybe that's the way to think about it. Or not.
I disagree, actually.
Go ahead, Soumya. I love it when you disagree.
I disagree.
She's so jet-lagged right now, by the way.
I am sorry, guys. bluntly put, I don't know why we're trying to be Netflix or Amazon. We don't need to be. Netflix and Amazon became a global phenomenon, and all of a sudden we all decided that we needed to be a Me Too. ZDF has been successful forever doing some of these things, and they do fine in their market. Mm-hmm. Yes, people are going to consume content in different ways, but I don't think that changes the basics. Yes, business models are being threatened by these new guys who can have new ways to print money.
Yeah.
Right? But I don't think that should change the basics of what it is.
It will change it if you can survive. as long as you can survive, you don't have to worry about the competition.
But I think what we're all doing is we're running too fast to the fact that we think that Netflix and Amazon have eaten our lunch. No, they haven't. They've grown the pie. They've made something possible for us to find new ways to consume data. I always tell people, it's like when I did the business model for this 5 years ago, people didn't understand. When I would say, we're going to launch an OTT, they'd be like, what is that, BBC America? What are you going to do? Do I have to turn on my phone? Right? I mean, I kid you not. But there was no barrier to entry. Now there's no challenges with the things we do. We launch a new feature, people run with it. Right? I don't have to explain anything. Right, and I think that's the opportunity that Netflix and Amazon have created for us. I mean, look, I agree that the world will change around us, but we don't have to be a Me Too.
Agree.
We have to be how can we be ourselves and still? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
I agree. I think it's not about being Me Too, and you're right to a certain extent that when you say that the dynamic of how you consume, how do you watch video has changed.
Scared you now.
We're changing the lexicon right here.
I'll give you a quick example, and I'm not sure if you would agree, but I watched, I came from the US, and the US, obviously, it's a strong market where cord cutting happens at the moment. And it's interesting, you talk to young people, and they'll tell you, I don't watch TV at all, I don't understand TV. But if you look at the content they watch, the videos they watch, it's actually TV content, they just consume it very differently. And I think there's a shift between, again, I want to watch linear TV in the millennial segment of audiences, that when I say, I don't want to watch something that's curated for everyone. I don't want to be tied by a time, I don't want to be tied by a location. I want to be free to consume what I want to consume. Again, I keep using that word, but I want to watch what I watch when I want to watch it, and on my time, on my terms. Yeah. And I think this is how the industry has shifted. So it's important for us to understand how do we serve that need. And then how do we produce videos, how do we surface videos, how do we present videos to people in a way that they want to consume them?
And maybe
consumption's an important word, because without consumptions, we wouldn't be making money.
Yeah,
if it was watching.
But also, just another point, and I hate to use that example because I do disservice to Europe, but throwing the towel is not the answer. A lot of people have said, don't even try coming up with new phones. Siemens and Nokia split the world.
That's right.
It's over.
Remember
and
those
then
days?
Those companies 10 years ago controlled the world, and now we can discuss where they are.
Yeah.
So I don't think in a dynamic world, and I think in terms of iteration, right? Things change, and you have to be just agile enough and smart enough to react quickly to serve, really, your users.
I'm going to try to fit in one more question here. This man in the back,
Yes, hello, my name is Timo Terani. I am a producer, and I used to work for ITV in Britain when the digital phase basically started. And when I returned to Germany, I realized here that people, and I think they're still a little bit slow in picking up on a lot of issues regarding technology. I don't know how it is in other European countries. However, I think the reaction nowadays, what the ZDF just said, is quite, they're testing the waters. Germans, I think, need to test a little bit the waters. That's our characteristic. Mm-hmm. However, I think they've done, they had successes recently, mm-hmm. and I think we have to think about structures within our landscape, channel landscape. Mm-hmm. And I think our old broadcasters are a little bit too big and not flexible enough, either to get engaged with them or to react to certain issues on the market or mm-hmm. competitors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I think that's one of the reasons why, for instance, Alexandar has launched a separate entity, right? Because he's part owned by ProSieben, but he's not inside of the ProSieben yeah. house, you know. So he's able to kind of be out here doing nice. Kind of like a skunk works, you know, sort of a, you know, a little company over here doing something else. You have to report in occasionally and say, "Hey guys, sorry, I'm spending a little more money and stuff like that." But you know, but you're trying to be more agile. You can't do that if you're inside the behemoth that is ProSieben or the behemoth that is the BBC.
Yeah,
or
by the way, even Google did that. I spent 10 years at the company. The reason that Alphabet came in and they turned, you know, the thermostats outside, right. the cancer treatment, the robotics, for the same reason. I mean, it's not bad to realize, for example, that something can be done separately.
Yeah.
So I think it's about, you know, whether you realize that quickly enough and whether you yeah. properly give it yeah. the freedom, which we do in yeah. our case. So yeah. it gives me hope, and I'm very excited about the opportunity rather than scared.
And let me just add one element on this missing this train thing, because this is discussed very often in Germany.
Yeah.
I think we haven't missed the train, but for someone who is really wants to do something now, it's just getting more expensive because we are later in that mm-hmm. game. Mm-hmm. And you have to really find good investment and you have to do it boldly.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I think this is something where we in Europe have been not as strong as other parts right. of the world, notably right. the US or China, right. To be bold and really to get it through and stick with it. Mm-hmm. And I think mm-hmm. as soon as a European investor would really do it like that and really put some money into it and stick with it, have a good idea, mm-hmm. then it would work. And mm-hmm. and let me just, because whatever was quoted, whatever being owned by a French company wasn't allowed to start in France because of some local rivalry.
Yeah.
And as
yeah.
long as we are doing this kind of thing, of course, the Americans will be here.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. I think this was a fascinating session, right? I mean, we heard this, just all kinds of stuff got surfaced. Could you please join me in thanking our very large and very influential panel, Soumya, Audrius, Annabelle, Alexandar, and Robert. Yay!